goal-setting meeting, so we figured this will be a good opportunity for you guys to get a good focus on what the year ahead of you looks like. We'll get in a little bit about that. If you are not yet a member of the group, I encourage you to consider it. Some of the benefits of it, obviously you guys had a chance. Those of you that this is your first time here, you got to see and meet people at the beginning. That's a big part of how this group is set up. You know, we structure it to have that half hour at the beginning to network. That's not an accident. That's because we think it's the most important part of groups like this. Obviously, we want to give you good content, but we want to make sure, first and foremost, that you get here and you get to meet other professionals. And we can never guarantee that everyone's going to stick around for the post-meeting networking.
My favorite networking part is in the networking lounge. And it could be 30 minutes, 60 minutes, 3 hours, day and a half.
They have rooms here, too.
Does everybody not have any paper to write off? Everybody's good? Because you'll need it later.
Okay. Good point. Yeah, thanks, Linda, for arranging that. Thanks for making sure that we get here.
No problem.
So yeah, there's a lot of folks here in all aspects of the business, a lot of investors like yourselves, contractors, there's a lot of suppliers here. I never liked that word vendor. I should probably change that. It always makes me think of that guy with the little paper hat serving hot dogs.
We could use one of
those. Yeah, that would be nice.
Put that on your agenda.
Paper hat, hot dog hat.
Hot dog stand. And just to add to what Dave said, in real estate, you need a team to be successful. You can't do it all on your own. You know, you need a good real estate attorney, you need a good title company, you need a good insurance company. CPA, you need a good CPA. So you need those people around you. They help insulate you from making mistakes. They'll get the job done for you. You don't have to know everything about real estate. You just have to get the right people around you. And coming to places like this allows you to not only meet those people, but if they're not here, you can always ask us for recommendations. We're not going to steer you wrong. We're going to put you with the pros.
Yeah, and always keep in mind when you start giving recommendations to people, it's a little off topic, but I'm always super thoughtful about whether or not I want to recommend. They have to have never really made a mistake for me that they haven't owned up to for me to recommend them to somebody else.
The other thing is you want to match them up with the similar personalities.
Yeah.
So that's important too. So I might have three or four attorneys I can recommend, and if you ask for a recommendation, I might, if I know you, and I'll try to match you up with somebody that you're going to like working with. Education. This is where it all starts. Somebody asked me, I want to get into real estate, I want to start buying some rental properties and doing that type of thing. Where do I start? Do I watch podcasts? I said, you start right here from the meeting. It's a great place to come to, again, for all these reasons. I said, don't get me wrong, podcasts and real estate guys, all that's great. But you got to come here, you got to learn here and network here.
You want to get advice from people that are in your local market.
Right. The podcast isn't going to tell you what the CPA to use in your account.
This one's.
Yeah.
Same record.
The other thing is we have access here to a state attorney general approved lease. So part of your membership is you get access to that. So you can use it in the district courts here in the county. And the justices are very familiar with the lease. So it'll make your life a lot easier. Not that it's going to be easy, but easier.
Nothing good is ever easy.
PRO membership. PRO is the Pennsylvania Real Estate Owners Association.
Got that right.
You put that extra letter. It only took a year and a half. We're going to talk. We'll talk a little bit about the benefits of that now. But this is kind of our political action group. So. We're going through some challenges right now with a local borough, and it looks like they're probably going to be helpful to us in that scenario.
Which borough is it?
West York. So if you guys are having any issues, see Gary before the end of the meeting, because there's been some challenges.
And Gary is our liaison for PROA. He goes to a lot of those meetings in Harrisburg, so he kind of has his finger on the pulse of what's going on. A lot of these boroughs and townships, the managers, the supervisors, they probably don't own any rental real estate, and they look at us as having real deep pockets. So a lot of times they're going to enact anti-landlord laws to try to suck more money out of us. So we have somebody we can turn to when things become unfair. And part of our membership, we send to them to give back for, you know, protecting our rights. So it's really important.
Well, our pockets might be deep, but they don't always have money in them. And then, of course, a lot of what we're going to talk about tonight, personal growth and motivation. It helps to come to events like this because there's folks here that are business owners, they're involved in building wealth for themselves, they're not in the 9-to-5 drudgery that you find yourselves exposed to on Monday through Friday. So it helps to get involved around other folks like that and keep you motivated, because it is difficult being in a business for yourself. You get to hang out with Eric?
That's fun.
Especially for those of you first-timers.
Please invite guests. You know somebody that is thinking about getting into real estate business? Bring them along. Or, you know, contractors, plumbing, electrical.
Good ones. General. Don't bring any of those crappy contractors.
Slackers. We're always looking for contractors. That's like a constant search. Always looking for good contractors.
We're going to give a shout-out to a couple of our sponsors. I want to point out Mr. Judah Huber, because I'm sure he's here and he's got to have something to say about this. But keep it brief.
Yeah, I just wanted to say you guys were running a conference over at the Lancaster Convention Center for, there's going to be all kinds of investors and speakers from all over the Mid-Atlantic area. It's going to be awesome. I've got some flyers that I'm going to hand out. If you are here, you could be a vendor or you should definitely attend. There's going to be a Friday, Saturday, Sunday. There's going to be a just kick-ass awesome event that I highly recommend that you attend. Use promo code Judah when you register, because we've got a little inner office thing going, and you get a little bit off if you use promo code Judah.
Spell it. That's great.
Spell it. What is it?
J-U-D-A-H. J-U-D-A-H. And yeah, I've just also seen this up here. Like, we've lined up with a bunch of different of our vendors that are going to be there, discounts available and things like that. So it's going to be like a trade show as well as, a trade show vendor expo as well as a really great conference. Harry, I went to these, coming up 15 years ago, there were these all the time. I'm sure that you've been to a lot of them, and they kind of went away for a while. And so we're just trying to bring back a great conference where selling isn't the point. Upselling people to a coaching program isn't what it's all about. It's about networking and getting people together and learning. And if you go to realestatehackersconference.com, you'll see amazing speakers that we've got lined up.
And this will be good because it's a regional event. So most of the people that you go are going to be from Lancaster, Harrisburg.
Yeah, we've got people coming from Philly, Allentown, Baltimore, all over the place. So yeah, it's definitely going to be a big event.
Yeah, you don't have to get on a plane and fly to Dallas or something to go to this one.
Spend the night in your own hotel. You spend the night in your own bed and drive back over across that big scary river the next morning.
We can do it.
I know how scared people are from York to go to Lancaster and Lancaster to go to York.
Right. So it's like, oh, I don't understand how to get around over there. And then the Lancaster people say the same thing about it.
Right.
We also want to thank Frank's Marble and Granite. Carmen's not here this evening, but they specialize in countertops, marble and granite, obviously, and others. But they have stuff available for people doing rehabs, too. I think Harry's got quite a few jobs that he's done.
Yeah, they have a contract for a flipper pack.
Also want to thank Darren Miller with Anchor Abstracting.
Say hi, Darren.
How are you, Darren?
Darren, our anchor company that's specializes in working with investors. Obviously, they'll close normal deals too, but they do a lot of investor work.
Is there any such thing anymore today as a normal deal?
I don't know. I haven't found one. It seems like every time I close a deal, people are like, why is it always your deal? So,
Darren says that about mine.
Yeah.
What? Difficult deal.
If it wasn't interesting, we wouldn't do it, right? Mark Scott, I know I saw
Where's
him.
Mark? There he is. I just called him the other day for another job. Got one of those green avocado color tubs. And Mark's company's going to come in and paint the whole thing. He actually did one in my personal house. It looks like a brand new tub. Beautiful.
Nice. And it doesn't look like the 70s anymore.
Yeah.
20-second commercial, so those of you that are either first-timers or if you're a member, we'll give you 20 seconds to announce yourself and tell you what you're interested in.
And if you don't feel like getting up, you don't have to. We're not putting any pressure on you. It's just, if you want to, you can get up and give a little commercial about yourself. Dave and I will kind of give you an example of a commercial that you want to
do. Yeah, my name is Dave Heisen. Real Estate Investors New York. I'm one of the owners of Country Home Real Estate. I'm a realtor, primarily a buy and hold investor. So I'm interested in anybody that is an agent that's looking to make a change.
My name's Harry Nail. I've been in real estate as a realtor for 34 years. And I'm also a fortune builders coach. So I coach students from across the country on how to get their real estate business up and running. And buy and hold. Flip, wholesale, do it all.
Yeah,
so if you ever need anything, give me, or if you have any questions, feel free to give me a call. Want to start at this table?
My name's Anthony Covington. Been to one meeting before, but I'm a law enforcement officer in my day job, and I've had one rental property for about 10 years, so I'm looking to expand that, looking at buy and holds here in the area.
Probably got a good background for this business.
My name is Elliot Hogan, just a York contractor.
My name is Chris Lynn Mann, and I'm a newbie. This is my first time at a meeting, and I'm looking to wholesale, do buying holds, and to do some fix and flips.
For the contractors, like, give me a card then when you're.
We can't wait.
Yeah. Yeah. We brought a lot.
Anybody here at this front table?
Everybody back there? No. Any new people over there?
Hi, my name is Preston Daly. I've been in the wholesale space for a little while. I came here to network with people, build stronger relationships in that space.
Ken Anderson from K&A Property Solutions. We're buying ugly and selling beautiful. So we based right here in York. If you're a wholesaler, lender, I want to talk to you before you leave.
Nice. I like that slogan. Nobody wants to. Nobody here.
My name is Nicholas. It's my first time at this meeting. I've been attending meetings all throughout the region the last couple weeks or so. I have two strategies. My pre-deployment strategy, I'm deploying to Afghanistan in the summer. My pre-deployment strategy is to hopefully, if all goes well, get at least two deals, wholesaling deals done. My post-deployment strategy, I'll have all that deployment money. I plan on purchasing some buy and holds, some burrs.
Well, I think I speak for the whole group here. Thank you for your service. Anybody new at this stage?
Yes. Walter Hicks is my name. This is most educational at this point for me. Get in and try and maybe learn exactly what I might want to do and more about the investing in general. So,
all right, well, welcome.
Yeah.
It's always good, you know, the least expensive time, the least expensive money is the money spent on education. Anybody else at that table?
My name is Livingston Lee. Been going to a lot of local meetings here in New York. Originally from Baltimore, Maryland, hoping to invest in both areas. Trying to close my first deal this month for an apartment house and looking to buy and hold going into the future.
So you're in the middle heads of that deal right now?
Yes, sir.
Good. Congratulations.
Thank you.
It's almost prices, right?
Yeah, that's all it tells sometimes, but yeah, I mean, my first one, so I feel good about it.
Good. Anybody else at that table?
Hi, my name is Ty Wilkinson. I'm with Merrill Lynch. I'm primarily looking for people that want to invest in real estate, but they have securities, products that they can borrow money off of and lend out as either hard money lending or lending out the money that want to just buy and flip houses.
Nice. Good. I'm glad you have an out-of-the-box perspective. Back corner there.
Is that guy new? Chief Budget Reynolds, Chief Cochran, a business partner, buy and hold investor, money lender, bullshitter, whatever you want to call it. Come see us at the meeting. We got stuff for sale. If you guys are interested in buying stuff, I hope you can buy, sell, trade, but if we don't, you know, come see us.
Price helps. Anybody else at that table? All right.
Hi, Johnny Throne, Commercial Loan Consultants. I'm a commercial mortgage broker. I'm doing commercial financing since 97. Anybody looking for money? Yeah, very happy to talk to you. I've got all kinds of funds.
The man loves coffee.
All right, how about this day? Anybody new? Okay. We're just doing
well, members.
John's not new.
Yeah.
My bad.
Sorry.
Go ahead, go.
I'm Seth. I worked for Bank of America in Maryland during the day. I started doing real estate a few years ago down in Austin. I did wholesale and stuff, and I moved here to York a couple months ago, so I'm starting to do wholesale up here. So.
Austin's a cool town.
Yeah, a lot different from New York.
Yeah, that was, I was going to say, that's a hell of a transition. Right, like, what the hell am I doing?
Yeah, it's cold.
We're looking for buy and holds as well as fix and flips. Any wholesalers? Talk to us.
Jose Sanchez, new to the wholesaling business. Just looking to expand and network with everyone and do the best that I can possible in this business.
Sounds good.
My name is Carolyn Payne, and I'm looking to fix and flip.
Okay. Now, you guys, I'll give you a recommendation if you haven't done it yet. If you're new, you don't have a business, if you don't have cards yet, at least get some cards that say, I buy houses or something, put your phone number on it, so you have something to give to people. Because you can get them Vista print really cheap.
If you have cards, make sure you know you give one to David.
Yeah. I can add them to my collection.
Any members?
Back to that. Well, let's get that people.
Hey guys, my name is Judah Hoover. I've been doing this for about 20 years. My goal is to help people get to the next level. I run a property management company. We manage about 4,000 units. That's probably the biggest way that we help people. And you're never too old to learn a few new tricks. I just closed on a deal last week that I lost $10,000 on. And so, you know, there's always room for improvement and learning and things like this. Never get lazy. Never stop being frosty, because there's always lessons to be learned, isn't there, Harry?
Always. You'll never. I constantly am learning. It's amazing. And at one of our Fortune Builders Masterminds, Dan Merrill said this, and I'll never forget it. He said, if you haven't lost money in a real estate deal, you're not doing enough deals.
Hmm. Yeah.
Sooner or later, you're going to screw up. Sooner or later, you're going to make a mistake and you're going to lose money. Even if it's you break even at the end of the settlement, if you put a lot of time into that, you lost money. Because your time is valuable in this business, and your time is money. So it's okay to make a mistake. It's okay to lose money once in a while, as long as you do enough deals that you're in the black at the end of the year.
You don't want to lose money and then make it up on volume.
Right.
Yes.
Are the show notes going to be available?
The
access needs at all?
Probably not. You'll probably just have to take good notes.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's all right.
There's nothing that we're going to go over that's like a super thorough thing. You're going to have to leave with your own notes. And you'll see why. But without ruining it.
I'm Bill Goodberlet. I buy and sell houses for cash. I do flips, looking for my next flip, so always on the lookout. Also looking for a referral for movers. So if anybody knows good movers, I'd like to talk to you and get their name and number.
Does anybody know good movers? I used to.
But most of your tenants, don't they move like that?
They keep moving out.
But they don't take all the stuff.
Yeah, they never take stuff. So. They apparently don't know movers either.
Yeah.
I got a tenant that start. I got a tenant that start that's a meeting, a prospect in a meeting tomorrow morning that has his own moving company. He's getting started.
Oh, yeah. That's a good one, a new guy.
He's a new guy.
So. Yeah. Mr. Ball is here. I haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah. Finally back.
Worley Generations is a family of York-based mover. Worley Generations.
West York guy.
Oh, yeah.
They're local. Good job.
All right, my name's Chad Eisenhart. I buy single-family, multifamily, and self-storage in York, and I also record meetups, about four meetups in Central PA, and it goes as Central PA Real Estate Investors Meetup Podcast.
Say that a lot louder.
Yeah, let me try again. Central PA Real Estate Investors Meetup Podcast.
It's free.
Free. So yeah, you can look up the notes there also.
Thank you, Chad, for joining us.
Hi, I'm Linda Dubbs. I've been doing real estate since 2010, been through the rentals and fix and flips, and now I'm only doing fix and flips. Hanover area, East Berlin, New Oxford, Littlestown, you know, the radius, maybe 15-mile radius. So if anybody has any wholesale deals or anything like that, please let me know. And I'm always at the front desk, so can't miss it. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Jason Hoogler. I'm the managing partner and broker of record of Country Island Real Estate. We're positioning ourselves to be the premier real estate investor agency in the Mid-Atlantic region. A lot of cool things going on. And I also help people buy and sell businesses through my other company, which is Exit Strategy Solutions.
A lot of people may have never heard of a business broker, but a business broker like Jason, they can just sell the business, but not the real estate. Some businesses that have value, especially if they're putting out a lot of dollars each year.
My name is George. I've been investing in rental property since the mid-90s around New York, and I'm currently at the point I'm starting to sell off some of the things I bought back in the early days. I'm thinking about selling a two-unit in the 500 block of Madison Avenue, so if you have any interest, please see me after the meeting.
My name is Mark Scott with Miracle Method. We do surface refinishing. So like Harry said, we make yellow, blue, black go away. So if you're looking to modernize, update without having to renovate an entire bathroom, particularly the old mud beds, something we can do in a day, make it bright white, save you a ton of money.
Yes, we'll get on with it. It's a good quote. Harry recommended this one. Setting goals is the first step to turn the invisible into the visible.
How many people set goals each year? Raise your hand. Fair amount. How many people write them down? Okay, better.
Talking about goals versus outcomes, it's very important as you're doing this on a yearly basis that you're really specific with yourself and honest with yourself. But it's important to specify what happens when you don't achieve a goal.
Reset it.
Yeah, working on it. You're just upset with yourself, maybe. You know,
a little depressed, maybe.
Yeah, you're like, oh, I didn't do this. This isn't working out for me. You know, it doesn't make you feel very good, does it? Now, how about if we rephrase that, and what happens if you don't achieve an outcome that you were hoping to achieve? It's not exactly the same. So in that case, you're always going to get an outcome, right? Might not be the outcome that you're looking for, but you're always going to get an outcome. So what that gives you is an opportunity to learn from that and say, hey, well, if I had done this or if I had done that, there might have been a couple different paths to achieving what I was trying to do. So when we talk about goal setting, it's important to look at that in terms of an outcome that you're hoping to get, because that's what that's going to do for you is giving you a multiple different ways to get to that result versus, hey, I'm going to either do this or I'm going to do that.
If you say you're going to buy 5 houses this year and you only buy 4, well, you didn't reach your goal, but 4 is still pretty good, right? You still had a good outcome.
Yeah, I quite frequently don't achieve a lot of the goals or outcomes that I'm looking for in a given year. But the objective with this is to be putting you on a path to be improving yourself constantly versus if you're not doing anything at all, what do you think your life is going to look like a year from now versus how it looks like now?
I'm going to be honest. I was one of those guys that I've heard, you know, presentations being in real estate sales, you know, for years. I was one of those guys that resisted writing it down. I don't know why. I don't need that. I would just put mental goals in my mind. Okay, I want to sell $5 million of real estate this year as a realtor. You know, buy one house or something like that. But I wondered if I would wrote them down and in a detailed plan on how I'm going to accomplish those goals, how much more I could achieve in my life so far at this point.
But if you forget, and if you're anything like me, I forget what I had for lunch yesterday. So there's no way in hell I'm going to remember what the goal was that I set back in January 1st.
By writing them down, it keeps you on track. It holds you accountable. And you can also have friends of yours that are in the real estate game doing the same thing, and you can have accountability partners. You know, you call each other once a week. Hey, how's it going? How's your week going? How are you doing with your goals? You know, did you door knock 20 doors? Did you, whatever your strategic plan of attack to achieve your goals is, did you do it? It's like going to the gym. You have a workout partner, right? Nobody goes to the gym. Nobody works out. Yeah, it motivates you because you don't want to let your partner down. You do the same thing in the real estate business. As a matter of fact, it's recommended.
This is something you probably can't see super clear from back there, but the important part is the main words on the outside. So this is what's known as the success cycle. So the whole idea starts with belief. So as you're setting these goals, you have to set things that you believe are achievable. You can't just say, like for instance, how many people think that they could run a marathon tomorrow morning in this room? Finish. So now, what if I say, how many people think by the end of the year you could run a marathon? You could train, and that's something that you could do by the end of the year. Gotta see something. You know, I mean, it's a possible thing. People do it every year. You know, and if you have the right training, and if you have a plan in place that you follow, that's something that you can make happen. And that might be a simplistic example, but you want to set goals that for yourself are something that you can, you think are achievable by the end of the year. Because what that helps is if you believe that it's possible, you're going to be able to tap into a lot more of your potential. So when it comes time to act on that, you're going to feel like very motivated to be able to do it. You know, if you set a goal that you don't think you're going to achieve, you're not going to use that much of your potential. And what kind of results are you going to get from that? You know, you're ending up poor results.
You're almost setting yourself up for failure before you start.
You know, and that kind of, and that this cycle works both ways. So if you get poor results, what does that do to your belief? You know, now you think, oh, well, I'm just a failure. I'm not going to be able to do this. So the cycle works both ways. So it's important to you that you set manageable and obtainable things and you do it in small chunks, because then when you achieve it, it gives you more confidence, and then you're able to do more stuff and just continue to work your way up the chain. Realistically, most people don't achieve the things that they're looking for in a year. It's not because they have too many goals. It's because you have too few. You know, you might have one goal like, oh, I'm going to make this much at my job, or, you know, I'm going to lose 10 pounds or whatever. Like, you might have three goals at the beginning of the year. And then you're like, oh, none of these are working out. You know, realistically, you should have a whole variety of goals in a bunch of different categories of your life, and this is what we're going to work with you guys on this evening. And then if you don't achieve every single one of them, that's not the big issue here. We want to make sure you're making progress in that category continuously. The other thing that people fail in goal setting is you don't have a way to relate your goals to what's important in your life. And so if it's not important to you, you're not going to be able to get leverage over yourself and motivate yourself to make it happen, because it's just another list on your to-do list, like pick up the dry cleaning or something like that. You know, it doesn't have any meaning to you.
A good example of that would be if you're single, you want to meet somebody, but you maybe have 30 pounds to lose. Wouldn't that be a good goal to keep in front of you, to try to lose that 30 pounds? Like, I'm going to look good for the opposite sex.
And for me, that's...
Or it could be your spouse. I want to look good, you know, to my spouse.
And that's kind of an important point about the goals, especially the health-related goals. I've never made a health-related goal that is about how much do I want to weigh. And this is important. Like, I don't even weigh myself. I'll set goals like, what do I want to be able to accomplish? Like, for my fitness goals, I want to be able to not be limited. If there's something I want to do, I don't want to be able to say, oh, I can't do that because I'm not in shape to be able to make that happen. So I think about, like, if I want to be able to do anything I want to be able to do within reason that I actually want to do it, you know, I want to be able to do that and not be physically.
But everybody that achieves something great had something motivating them. They just didn't decide to do this one day, and they became great at it. There was something inside of them that was a burning desire to be great, that motivation. It doesn't matter what it is. You just need to have it.
And you can't be too hard on yourself, too. Like, if one day you don't live up to your potential and you let yourself down in some category of your goal setting, you can't be like, oh, that's it, I'm a failure, I give up for the entire year. You just gotta look at the next day and say, well, how can I do better than I did yesterday? And, you know, it won't become a habit. You know, bad habits get broken or good habits start.
If you wanna become financially independent and in real estate in 20 years, for example, let's say you're 40, by the time you're 60, you wanna be financially independent, you gotta figure out how much you need, first of all, to survive at that age. And then you just work it backwards. Okay, if I'm gonna make $4,000 from every single family house in the city I buy, how many houses do I buy? And then you can break it down from there. But you need to be strategic in your planning. When the Super Bowl's next Sunday, or this coming Sunday, they don't just go out and like, okay, just like Sandlot, make the plays up as you go. Although sometimes they actually do. But there's a game plan, and that's their goal, is to follow that game plan. And if they can follow that game plan, they're going to win. But guess what? At halftime, the coach is in there changing the game plan because it didn't work. Or it's working, but we need to tweak this area and this area, and I think we're still going to win. So there's always got to be a detailed game plan with how you're going to accomplish that goal. We're going to get into that in more detail later.
Yeah, and you think about those guys, like how long they've been practicing the game of football to get where they're at. To be playing in the Super Bowl. You know, it started when they were kids.
You know, a lot of work, a lot of weightlifting, running.
And none of that stuff, you know, in its own is going to make or break it. But as you aggregate it across someone's entire career, it
pros. What's the difference between Kobe Bryant? He worked his ass off. He had some burning desire within him to be the best he could be. I'm not sure where it came from, where he got it, but he had it. Unruly, unfortunate what happened, because everybody liked Kobe. But he had that burning desire to win and to be the best he could possibly be. And that's what fueled him every day in the weight room or on the court. He had that desire, and he kept that goal right here in front of him. He thought about it. He had to think about it all the time. Nobody works that hard. Nobody works that hard without having that goal, that vision right in front of him.
Otherwise, it's just work, right?
Yeah, otherwise it's just work. But for him, it probably wasn't even work. He probably enjoyed every minute of it.
So the other issues with goals is, like we said, breaking that goal down into daily activity. You know, what can I do today that's going to get me closer to that goal? And then the other thing is what to do after achieving a goal.
Party! Woohoo! Celebrate. It's okay to celebrate a win. At Fortune Builders, they call it a win. You got a win, you sold a house, you flipped it, you made $25,000, $30,000. Take the wake up for dinner, real nice dinner, and celebrate that win. It shouldn't all be about work, 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 work. And I get caught up in a little bit of that at times. So I have to say those things to myself. Like, okay, slow down. Let's have some fun with family and celebrate this win.
Yeah, it's important to do. Otherwise, you can definitely burn yourself out. All right, so now we're going to get into it. We're just getting started.
It's a fun part.
So, foundationally, you need to break up these goals into various, basically your entire life into some categories, because there's going to be goals, and then there's going to be areas. So a category is basically long-term or lifelong, where an outcome is temporary. So if I look at everybody's category in this room, they're probably going to be very similar. You know, like physical fitness, real estate, like rental holdings, or sales, or whatever your business.
Let's just say work.
Right. So you're going to have work. Probably 4 to 8 that are work-related, and then 4 to 8 that are your personal life. And I'll point this out tonight, that your personal life goals are just as important as your business goals. And it's also very important that you develop clear outcomes for those personal goals. Because, you know, when I look back, like over my last year, almost all of my business goals were like achieved. But then I'm like, oh, I'm struggling in a particular area. And I'm like, why? Well, I look back at the goals that I set at the beginning of the year, and they're super generic, like improve such and such relationship, or, you know, they were really weak. There was no vision at all. So it's very important to have clarity around all those goals as well. So importantly, start thinking about your categories for your business and the categories for your personal life. Really think about it, because I'm going to put you on the spot here in a minute. So these are all good examples.
I heard it one time, it's like juggling 3 balls. You've got family, you have health, and you have business. And you need to juggle them and keep them all afloat at the same time. If one gets too weighted, work gets too weighted, what's going to happen to the other? You're going to drop them. They're going to break. So it's we have to keep that juggling going. So.
And this is super important because, and we're going to break right after I get done talking, we're going to break for a little bit, and you guys are all going to write down at least 4 personal categories and 4 professional categories and some goals for the year.
Dave and I will come around and help you if you get stuck, because it's kind of putting you on the spot a little bit here. But it's okay. We're all going to share our goals, and we're going to hold each other accountable, and that's how we're going to do
it. We didn't tell you this is going to be participatory. So our objective is you're going to leave here with some stuff that you can work on this year.
Then when you take it home, do not throw it in a drawer. tape that above your desk or someplace where you're going to see it every day. And if you read that every day, you're going to be amazed at the results next year at this time. Matter of fact, I'm looking here forward to hearing from some of you next year on how you did on your goals.
And the reason it's important to have different categories and to have goals for each is, you know, if you don't have any goals for your health, and you go through like your whole year with all these business goals, and then what's going to happen? You'll have some injury or sickness or something, and then that's going to knock you out for like 2 weeks. And it's probably going to be the busiest 2 weeks of the year when you have all kinds of stuff going on. And that's going to cost you money. If not like directly out of your pocket in health costs, it's going to cost it in productivity. And when you're thinking about being in business for yourself, your productivity is important, because that is yours, it's not your employer's, you know. Plus, you want to have enough energy that if you are working a full-time job, when you get done the job at the end of the day, you're not completely exhausted, or you don't like sleep in half the day Saturday because you're worn out from giving your time to somebody else all week long. You want to be able to have that to work on your own dreams and goals, not somebody else's.
One of the Fortune Builders Mastermind, Stan Merrill, gave us a copy of his schedule for 1 week. It was unbelievable. I mean, he had, when he woke up, when he was at the office, every appointment blocked out, gym every other day for, you know, 1 hour, and he accomplished every one of those things. If I do that, I always seem to lag behind, and then it's like, oh, I get to the gym tomorrow. No, and tomorrow is the next day and the next day. He is an amazing entrepreneur, and that's probably why they've just hit over $1 billion in syndications. 4 years. You hear that, Judith?
Yeah.
4 years, over $1 billion.
What's that? 4 years, $1 million,
the owner,
right?
The owner, a billion. The owners of Fortune Builders?
I thought it was $1 million.
They just hit $1 billion in syndications. They just posted another one today in Sarasota, Florida, off the big office building. These guys are incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible.
All right.
And they post goals. They post goals.
Great, guys. We're going to give you a minute.
5 minutes.
Five.
Okay.
Maybe 3. It's a whole year. So basically what you're going to do, 4 personal categories, 4 professional categories, come up with at least a goal for each for the year.
And if you're new, guess what? Education should be a part of your goal, right? You know, we're going to go to the monthly meeting. I'm going to listen. There's so many podcasts that we have going on. You know, read things on the internet or read some books, real estate related books. Anybody read a good real estate book lately?
That's a good book.
Yeah, Rocket Fuel.
Rocket Fuel?
Yeah.
I read that. Well, I read some of it.
Rocket Fuel.
Okay, I read the Flip Notes.
Long Tail's good. It's not real estate, it's more business. But Long Tail's good.
Of course, I made all that.
It was categories, right?
Yeah.
Problem is, each of you on staff is right now a math test.
thanks, man.
Are you cold?
What's your podcast? It's Central PA. It's a Central PA real estate investor meetup podcast. Central PA.
Central PA.
Real estate investors
meetup. Hey, so I got a question. So do you want broken down into
this on iTunes. About 3 months.
I didn't want to do. If that's what we're going to next step, I just want to do that.
Do you want to tomorrow? What you talk
to make it like 60 grand.
Yeah,
services, and down below there is some of the things we have had. Your name there and your phone number.
Sure.
We're going to send out time, dates, and
get me closer to that half. because you can't always just take a yearly goal and break it down into a quarter. You can't always just break a whole yearly goal down into four portions. Guys, hey, we're going to get back on with this. You can't just break a yearly goal down to four portions all the time. Sometimes there's different things you're going to do in the first or second quarters that's going to help you get to the end. It's not just, you know, like, I can't think of a good example, but you can't just always, they don't always lend themselves into just being broken up into four pieces. Sometimes you have to do something in a specific quarter in order to be ready to go to the next one. And I do recommend, you know, that's kind of how business operates, is by quarter. So if you're working on it for yourself, particularly with your business goals, it's easy to put them down by quarter. It makes sense. Your personal goals might not work that way. You know, there's probably stuff you're going to be doing all year long, the same stuff all year under personal goals, and you're going to have to remind yourself of it every week, every day maybe, not just, oh, well, I've spent time with my wife, now it's Q2, I spent a lot of time with her in Q1, I can just go on more business trips in Q2, because I'm good there. It doesn't work that way. Yeah.
One of my family goals that I wrote down this morning was to spend more time with my daughter doing activities. Now, it doesn't mean you have to go out and spend a lot of money. You know, working alongside your kids is quality time. People think, oh, well, I got to go to Hershey Park, or we got to go here, we got to go there, we got to spend money. No, they just want your time. They might not say that, but I need to spend more quality time with her. I work with my wife, so we spend a lot of time together. I'm not sure it's quality time.
Yeah, so you might have a goal of quality time, but they're outside of the office, right?
There you go. So that's one of my goals. So I broke it down per week. And like I say, it could be, hey, we're going to go clean out this garage that people left. They're wonderful possessions. And we're going to take it to the insurance. Just doing stuff like that, you know, throwing it in the trailer, and doing stuff like that together is quality time. That don't always remember that. Yeah. I always remember my two sons when they might have been 11 and 12 or 10 and 11, something like that. I drug them all to a rental property. They're going to paint Saturday and Sunday. How do you think that went? Kicking and screaming the whole way. And I said, hey guys, I'm going to pay you. I'm going to pay you $2.50 an hour. Hey, for 12 years, 11 years old, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Plus, that's unskilled labor.
Yeah,
I think the child labor laws go way too far.
It's Harry's paid apprenticeship program.
So, you know, they were not good at first, and they fought me, but, you know, parenting is not about taking the path of least resistance. It's about making the right decision, doing the right thing, and not the popular decision. So, you know, the second day when we were all finished, and I gave them, you know, their money, actually it was in the form of a check, it's tax deductible. Colton, my oldest son, I'll never forget it. He looked at that check, and he kissed it. He was so pumped up. I was even surprised. I was like, mission accomplished. Plus, I got the place paid.
Hey, yeah, you could have just gave them that money and they wouldn't have even come and you would have got anything.
They wouldn't have appreciated it because they didn't work for it. And they appreciated the time. That he still brings that up once in a while.
Nice. Win.
That's a win, baby. So then I went out and celebrated. With all that extra money I had, I had to pay somebody $10.
So those goals are really important. You know, it's easy for type A personalities, people that are in business, to neglect these types of goals. But it's very important. You don't want to like get to the point where your kids moved out of the house and you're like, oh, look how hard I worked and all this money I made and your kids don't want anything to do with you. So make sure you set goals in this category too.
Or they don't have any skill sets on their own because you didn't feel like dragging them to the job, kicking and screaming, right? Because it is a pain in the ass. And up because you're teaching them. So that means you're not doing it, but it's worth it. You got to do it.
So important thing, and we stress this up front, but in all these goals, you know, I saw a lot of people with goals that were kind of mechanical. It's important not to think about what the goal is, but what that goal means for you. You know, so if you're thinking about losing weight, what does losing 20 or 30 pounds, what does that mean to me in my life? Not, I'm just gonna lose this weight. Because if that's your goal, and then you don't, if it doesn't have meaning for you, you're not gonna take concrete steps to make it happen. So it has to have meaning, and then you have to think of ways that you can achieve that, multiple ways, not just one way. You know, it's like, oh, I'm just not gonna eat for the next 3 weeks. Well, that's probably not gonna end well. Or, you know, it might get you to your goal temporarily, but you're looking for a long-term improvement, not a short-term
fix. That long-term goal is longevity. You're gonna live longer. It's proven, if you're heavy, you're not gonna live as long. Thinner people live longer. It is.
And I was thinking,
you're going to feel better too, right? If you're 25 pounds overweight, think about this. We all know what a 25-pound barbell weight is that you put on, like you're going to bench press, right? You've got 25-pound weight on, right? Imagine putting that on your back and walking around every day, every minute, every second of the day with that 25 or that 50 pounds on your back. Think what that does to your legs, your feet, your ankles. I'm going to give you guys something to think about.
Plus, how many of you, there's a lot of business owners in the room, right? How many people pay for their own health insurance? Non-company. So every time I spend money on healthy food or I work out, I'm like.
I never gave that a thought.
Oh, yeah.
That's brilliant. It is. Because now the dollar signs come in. Not only do we want not want to be sick, but we're going to outlay a hell of a lot of money now.
So it's always better, like when, especially when you're thinking about buying food, is it worth it to buy higher quality food? You know, you don't want to buy medicine later because you have some kind of problem because you ate a bunch of fast food instead.
All you got to do is cut out the sugar out of your diet, which is carbos and regular processed sugar. You do that, weight's going to come right off. You're going to feel better, get less inflammation. So those are those little things you can put in there. Okay, how am I going to lose that? I'm gonna cut sugar out of my diet. No sugary drinks, you know, all that stuff.
And we're harping on this stuff because it's kind of the easiest for a visual of how your goals are. Your other stuff might be a little bit more complicated. But same thing, really. You know, you're not just gonna think of one way to achieve the goal. You wanna have multiple options because, you know, no plan survives contact again. And you're gonna have to, like, once you get out in the real world, shit's gonna start happening. And you're gonna have to figure out, well, what am I going to do now to get to where I want to be? Like, how am I going to overcome this setback and still achieve what I want to have?
I'm going to get on a stationary bike twice a week and I'm going to lift weights twice a week for 30 minutes. It doesn't have to be, you don't even have to do it for 30 minutes. If you do something every day for 15 minutes, it's a cumulative compounding effect. It's actually a book called a compound effect. I read the clip notes on that too.
You gotta get Harry on all of it.
I know, that's what I should do.
So, and that, going back to that, some of you guys that have reading-oriented goals, which is a good thing, you know, I have to be honest with myself, I'm too busy, like, I haven't forced myself into a good reading habit yet. So, well, I'm starting to get a little bit better this year at it, but I spend a lot of time in the car because I do a lot of sales work. So I've got Audible, and I'll listen to books. So that's kind of got that content into my head and made a productive use of otherwise unproductive time. And I've still got to the end result. I didn't read the books that I wanted to read, but I still got the content. You know, so it's kind of a, I'm not going to absorb as much as I would from reading a book, but hey, it's better than nothing, you know.
For me, I think I would get more out of the audio. Because I start reading, I get to page 4, and my mind's over here and here and here, and I kind of get lost in the book, but not in a good way. So I think the audio would actually.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of people like that, you know. So don't fight against your own nature. you know, like, and going back to the health thing, if there's activities that you like to do that are like playing basketball or doing things like, I don't run because I enjoy running, I run because it's effective. But there's other things you could do, like if a friend's like, hey, you want to go for a bike ride or you want to do this, that, or that, you can work things like that into your routine to get your goals and to have a good time while you're doing it. So this is the Harry just asked me about this a couple minutes ago. I'm like, I have no idea what the acronym stands for without looking at the sheet. But so this is about SMART goals. So you want to remember that SMART acronym. And what this stands for, because you probably can't see it back there, is specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and the T is time-bound. So, did everyone get that?
No.
Just SMART. Specific, measurable, attainable, relevant, and time-based.
What Dan was just talking about, I'll give you a good analogy, dog training, right? Everybody likes to go out in the backyard, throw the ball to the dog, right? Maybe your dog's trained, maybe it's not, but for the people who want to train dog, but it's not trained, use playtime, incorporate that into your training. So in other words, when they bring the ball back and drop it, make them sit before you throw it again. They don't even realize you're training. They just think they're having fun. So I'll make, you know, by the way, we just had puppies 10 days ago. I'll make one sit there and one sit there, and they have to sit there for whatever, 20, 30 seconds before I throw. And then I'll do something different. Then I'll make one lay down, get one up. So I do things like that. It's fun, but I'm incorporating training at the same time. And again, they don't even realize it.
And people are the same way. So, you know, you learn best when you're engaged in something you're excited about and you play.
Exactly. So if you can incorporate any of your goals into something or somebody else to make it a little more enjoyable, like lifting weights, jogging, whatever.
Yeah, that's why I participate in a lot of 5Ks where there's beer at the end of it. Just fun.
I start jogging.
Right. Sometimes it really sucks, but it's not the beer, I mean just the run itself.
Oh.
So write it down and schedule it. So that's why we made you guys, why we took that time out, made you guys write these down. And we wanted you to put by such and such quarter, by the end of the year, because a goal without a timeline is really just a wish. You know, it's like, I hope this happens, but you haven't set a time frame in which it needs to occur, so you're not going to take any concrete steps to realize that.
And if you miss because life got in the way, soccer practice, this, that, you know, I just didn't get to do my 30 minutes on the computer, real estate education tonight. Tomorrow, do an hour. Make up for it.
And
sometimes you have to cut things out of your life to achieve your goals. But I'm a terrible time waster in the mornings. I got the news on. I just waste too much time in the morning. So one of my goals is be in bed by 11:30 instead of 12:30, I guess. And get up a little earlier and move. Get going, jump in the shower right away, go down, hammer a cup of coffee, you know, breakfast, and out the door. In an hour. I should be able to do that, right?
Yeah.
I sit around and watch Fox News.
That's me too. I'm horrible
at that. One of my goals is to get my ass out. That's a whole hour in my day.
Yeah, think about your commute.
What can I do in that hour?
You know, if you guys are working a job where you commute very far, make sure you take into account time spent driving to and from that job as part of your time that you're not getting paid for. So if you think, oh, I'm making 20% more at this job than I could at a closer job, but you're spending 20% more time traveling, you're just driving around wasting your life away, really.
Instead of listening to music, do like Dave said, do an audiobook.
But
made me think about something I did last year, which was, you know, achieve two goals with one action, you know, more efficient. Because I was the same way, like I waste so much time in the morning, I wouldn't get out until 10 o'clock and I'd piss every single day.
Every day?
2 hours of wasted productivity.
I did it all last year.
And then, you know, my wife was taking the kids to school, so she hated doing that and having to pick them up. So I was like, oh, I can take the kids to school, of course, we get out of the house at 7:30. In the office an hour and a half earlier, so I got a happier wife. And then I got a more productive day.
Awesome. Win-win.
How much more could you make dollar-wise
with that extra hour a day? Add it up, like a year and a half.
Plus, now you have to spend time with your kids in the morning.
Yeah, well, so yeah, so that was three.
Right? May or may not be a good thing.
Anybody else have any examples like that? Things they tweaked or did differently and it made a big difference?
Paid a trainer, $25 for half an hour. Make sure I got up and went to meet him because I had already made the commitment.
Thanks.
You made that commitment, and he held you accountable, right?
Yep.
That's a good way. Put your money on the line.
How long have you been doing that?
A year.
How you feel?
Better.
Good.
Stronger. More flexible. Better endurance. Nice. Resting heart rate down.
I think you should probably feel great then.
Good. So you have measurable results from
that. Yes. Okay.
That's very important.
Thanks.
Yeah, and you gotta know yourself and get out of your own way a lot of this stuff. You know, I have this marketing program that I use where I market to a bunch of my clients. Well, letters would come, and then I wouldn't send them out. So I'm like, I'm just gonna pay somebody to send these out so that they're done, and it happens. You know, now it happens, and I have business.
Otherwise,
how that works. Yeah. Yeah, imagine all the business I didn't have coming in, but they were just sitting there accumulating in a pile. Commit. Burn the boats. You got to leave yourself no other option. You know, you've already set a goal that you know is achievable. This is why it's important to not go over the top with the goal. You have to make sure you have an achievable goal. So, and then not leave yourself the opportunity to weasel out of it. And if you do, don't be so hard on yourself. Tomorrow, you have the opportunity to do it again. Like, if you ate a cookie today, or whatever have you, donuts, you ate donuts at the office, whatever, like, tomorrow's gotta be a little bit better, right? Don't say, oh, I give up. You know, this is, you know, not the heart and health thing, but this is why dieting feels so frequent. Because people are restricting themselves from something that they want to do, and they don't have a clear purpose for why they want to do it. So it's really easy to not do it. So every category that you guys made this evening, you want to create a vision for each one of those categories. And you want to be realistic, but not fatalistic about your current situation. So think of your current situation like it is. Don't think about it like it's worse than it is. Most people aren't thinking about the current situation as better than it is. People just have that kind of mentality to go to the lowest common denominator. But people often are like, oh, this is, you know, the situation's horrible. It's not really horrible. And basically, you want to compare what your vision is to what your current reality is. And that's how you're going to break up your year to take you from where you are to where you want to be. But it's important to assess where you're currently at.
My long-term vision is, my daughter's 14, when she graduates, we want to move to the Florida Keys, if not full-time, you know, 8-9 months out of the year, maybe come back here for a couple months. So that's my goal, that's my vision. I used to have it, I don't know what it happened to. I had something taped above my desk. It was this beautiful house on a canal in the bay, and it was at a pole, and it was like, that's my Florida Keys house, right? Well, Florida Keys is expensive. So I want to have two houses. I know what I need to do. I know how much I need to be able to make in these next couple years to achieve that goal. But I that's always in my, like we were talking about Cody, having that burning desire to be a winner and be the best he can be. That burning desire of mine is to have that dream in Florida Keys. I think about it all the time.
hear stories from being around these about people having a picture of a house or something and then buying the exact house that they had on their vision board or on their computer later in life without even, you know, realizing it.
Or they got a 67 blue Corvette.
Right.
Did I get that year right, Brian? So it could be a car, it could be whatever. Whatever fuels you, it doesn't matter what that motivation is. You just have to have it.
So now, once you have your quarterly goals and you have a vision connected to each category, you're going to take those, because now a quarter is really just like the next 3 months. So you can break that up into weekly outcomes. It's relatively simple. You have a quarter, here's what I want to have by the end of the first quarter. Honestly, the toughest thing about making your whole year is making the whole year and then making the first quarter. Because you just made the whole year, you spent all this time, now you got to spend almost a considerable amount of time to put the first quarter together. But once that's done, the subsequent ones are much easier. And then what I do is every Sunday evening, I just plan out the week. And I reference, what did I not get done last week? What are my goals for Q1? And where did I, like, from my weekly outcomes for last week, where did I not get it? And then that's what drives what happens this week. So there's always going to be a variety of garbage that goes into your weekly schedule. It's just stuff that hasn't occurred in that week and things that are inconsequential. But you want to make sure that most of what happens in your week is goal-related or relates to what you want to happen. That, what that means you're in charge of what happens to your schedule. It's not just happening to you.
If your goal is to buy a house quarter, for example, for rental, and you don't have the funds to buy a house quarter, well, that means you need to get owner financing. And you're going to drive for dollars. So in other words, you're going to drive around and look for distressed houses. You're going to look for, maybe you're just going to door knock. One of the most effective ways to buy houses, believe it or not, is door knocking. Now, who in here likes to door knock on strangers' houses? Yeah, nobody. Other than Elvis.
Other than weirdness.
Dude,
Elvis.
When I first became a realtor, I door knocked. And I was really effective at it. I mean, I had 3 listings on one block.
We have a new agent in our office. He picked up a bunch just door knocking. It's like, dude,
nobody wants you to do it. There's actually a real technique to that, but you might have to say, okay, I'm going to door knock 30 doors a week to buy that one house per quarter so I can find a seller who's willing to sell it to me without financing. So every week, you know, okay, here's my days that I can door knock. Well, if you have to dock 30 and you only have 30 minutes of those 3 days, well, you need to do at least 10 doors. That 30 minutes. Because you are going to get that old lady that's going to talk your ear off and be here for 20 minutes. And she's going to invite you in for cookies and tea. It happened to me. But if you do that, I'm going to take a little sidestep here. There's a real technique to door knocking. Most people go up to the door, right? Salespeople don't know what they're doing. They knock on the door, and what do they do? Stand there, right? The little old lady or man peeks out by the curtain. Never opens the door, way out! You can't yell through the door, that's not. When you knock on that door, what you want to do is you want to turn around, walk off that porch, walk down the sidewalk. Are you threatening now? No. You're very non-threatening. I'm from here today at the front door. A little old lady's going to open the door. Do not approach her. Say, hello, ma'am. Hey, I'm just checking. I just sold a house in the neighborhood here at that listing down the block, and we got a ton of calls from buyers that want in this neighborhood. Do you know anybody that might be willing to sell their house? Did you notice I didn't ask him if she wanted, he wanted to sell his house? No, I said, do you know anybody? Them little old ladies know everybody and everybody's business on the whole block. Oh yeah, that guy over there, I think they're getting divorced over here. And then you can kind of, and she's going to come out on the porch then. And she's going to, and then you can kind of, and then you get invited in for coffee or tea and cookies. It's amazing how it works. It's brilliant, actually. Because when you're standing at the door, it's pretty threatening for a little old lady. You know, somebody who's 6 foot, 6 foot 2, 5, whatever. You know, it's threatening. So got to do is have the drive and the will to get out there and bust them up.
So once you have like what you're going to do this week, that's what happens. That's what breaks down into every day. What activities are you going to take to achieve those outcomes for the week? You know, so if you're, and I try not to make things like I'm going to do something every day, because I don't think that's realistic. Like, if you tell yourself you're going to do it every day, you're probably going to mess up Monday, and then you're like, oh, I already blew it. So the rest of the week, you're not doing it. But if you say I'm going to do something two or three times over the course of the week, and then you get off on the right foot, you do it Monday, now you have the whole rest of the week to do it the other second or third time, you know, if it's working out or making calls or what have you. And sometimes if I mess up, like if I say I'm going to do something 10 times a week and then I don't do it Monday, the 10 times a week isn't really the end-all, be-all. You really just want to make yourself do it. If I'm too intimidating that now I have to do it four times Tuesday, I'll just say, I'll make the same goal. I got to do it two times today because I didn't yesterday. But I'll inflate the goals to be more than I need to do in the week so that if I only do it 4 days out of five, it'll still work out. If that makes any sense.
And I work with the Fortune Builder students all the time, and they're like, because we give them homework each week. We give them action items, they call it. And it's to help them get their education in real estate. They might have to watch a certain amount of classes in the mastery, Portugal's mastery computer system or whatever it is. They might have to go hang 10 band signs or whatever it is. And they go, I didn't get that done because, you know, life got in the way. But there's other people, they got that done and more. The person that didn't get it done, wasn't a burning desire. Her desire wasn't to be great, to be a winner. And those people are the people that aren't going to make very much money in real estate. Matter of fact, sometimes I get off the phone with them, I go, that guy ain't going to make a dime. It doesn't happen. It doesn't have that desire. It doesn't have that vision.
Yeah. I remember the
He's not willing to work hard to get it.
Sorry. I remember the first time we ever hung up a bandit sign. We made one sign. Put it up. Oh, nothing's happening. This isn't gonna work. So then we ordered 500 of them and put them up everywhere, and then people started calling.
Yeah, it was just on the news apparently. I saw the worst city bandits.
I laughed. I'm like, oh good, there's some guys out there hustling.
So
hopefully not getting caught.
They'll probably get fines.
So
I was one of them.
So
fortunately, nobody, Terry wasn't there, and I got the reporter.
if you have a big enough vision and you have clear goals, you're going to start to get really resourceful about achieving those. And you kind of want to categorize all the resources you have to help you make that happen. Like, hey, there's a gym down the street, and it's only $10, or somebody can work out with me, or there's a softball league here, whatever it may be.
Ask and you shall receive. Ask for help. There's all kinds of people that are willing to help you.
You know, if you think you don't know enough, there are there's podcasts and stuff that you guys can listen to. Come to these meetings as often as you can. You know, audible. Get an education if that's one of your goals. Execution. You know, this is kind of where the rubber meets the road. So if you fail to win, you plan to fail. You got to plan each week versus just letting the week happen to you. So if you don't, go ahead, Jeff.
I think it's kind of rude that you guys are the guys speaking, and we've got other guys that think that this is about them.
Guys,
here for this meeting, and if you want to go have a cup of coffee, go ahead. Sorry.
Darren.
Getting old.
You're talking about you guys.
So what we do last week is from the previous week, you want to gather up your to-dos for the following week And then you want to consider out what the outcomes are for the week and how they relate to each vision. That's very important for each week, is to connect that stuff with what's important to you, because otherwise you're just doing that same thing of like making to-dos that aren't meaningful. If they're not meaningful to you, you're not going to keep making that.
And Brian and I were talking about that at break. Every night I look at this past day. Okay, oh, I didn't get to make that phone call, I didn't do this, I didn't do that. So I'm going to shift it over to the next day. And like Dave said, you want to have that weekly goal, but you got to monitor yourself each night. And if you write down your to-do list for tomorrow, you will sleep better. That's a proven, proven fact. Because your mind's not thinking, okay, what have I got to do tomorrow? I got to do this, I got to do that. Oh, I knew there was something I'm forgetting. But if it's written down, and you do it the night before, because you got to do it tomorrow, you'll sleep like a baby. Because you know your tasks are completed.
Yeah, I'm never really stressed out worrying about what's going to go on for the next day. And my fiance, she'll wake me up, she'll be like, oh, can you write this down? I'm like, oh, or remind me to do this in the morning. It's like, I'm not going to remember that in the morning. I don't remember it right now. It's like, you should have wrote it down. You know? The other thing is, when you're making these lists, group-related activities, because that makes things relevant to you in your mind, too. And if you really get fancy with it, you can start blocking out time in your week which you're going to do these things. I'm not that thorough with it. You know, I kind of plan on a daily basis when I'm going to do it. But that's a good practice. So, and most importantly, stay motivated with it and persist at it. You know, just keep working on it. So forget being calm and settled about this. You need to, once you get your goals down, you want to say, what can I possibly do? What can I do, not what can happen, to make these things a reality? And then just get right after that. You know, and even if I find myself in a situation where it's like, oh, things aren't going right, I have to like take myself out of that and be like, what can I do right now to make this happen? It happened today at the office. Jason and Tiffany, I had people supposed to show up for a class. Nobody showed up. Jason had a meeting going on, nothing happened. And we've been talking about getting this marketing material done for weeks. And we're like, well, let's just do it right now. So we just stopped, we did it. And that was one of my important things to get done this week. So because I had that in the back of my head, that was a priority to me. I didn't find something else to do at the time, because I could have. But it was a priority, both people were available, and we got it done. But you gotta do that sometimes. If you don't know what's important to you during the week, distractions are gonna come up, and they're gonna make you lose your focus. And before you know it, you'll go through the whole week. I remember when I used to be an employee, and I would go through a whole week or a whole day, and everyone else was like that too. They'd be like, I didn't get anything done today, or I didn't get anything. Well, it's all fun and games when someone's still paying you on Friday. But when it's up to you, not getting anything done during the day or in a week is not acceptable. You know, and if you haven't gotten closer to your goals at the end of the year, there's nobody to blame but yourself. So you have to make sure that you're having goals and staying focused on them.
I get the most done when I'm jam-packed. When I don't have anything to do and I got all the stuff to work on, it just seems like hardly anything. I used to study for tests the night before, you know, and the next morning. Walking in, close your books. That's just me. ADHD, that's just me. But it worked for me, so. You got to take action. We all heard the expression, knowledge is what?
Power.
That's bullshit. They've been feeding you that crap all your life. Knowledge is just knowledge. You know what power is?
Action.
Implementing a game plan, putting it into action, that's power.
You can execute a poor plan over and over and just make it progressively better. It's a lot better than if you have the best plan in the world. There's people that have the greatest business ideas, but they never leave their mind and never become anything. You know, there's people putting out second-rate products, but they get them out. Look at the guy, I'm not gonna say this is second-rate, but the guy that has MyPillow, he didn't invent the pillow. There's nothing novel about what he's doing.
He's made a better mousetrap.
And he just persists with it.
You guys watch Shark Tank?
Oh, yeah.
Could you imagine being the guy's first investor as he comes to you and he's like, guys, I got this great idea. We're going to make pillows, and we're going to sell them to people on the internet. And he's like, you know, and he's coming to you for money. Like, get the hell out of here. You're crazy.
I got to tell you, my wife and I have them. Freaking awesome. Who has a mock pillow?
Are you serious?
Look at that. Five people out of this room. Think across the country how many damn pillows that guy sold.
I won't sleep without it.
He had a dream and he took action.
You know, you can see.
I was skeptical, but I'm telling you what. I would fight you for my pillow.
And even the name.
I have a memory foam deal and I threw that away. It's a good bill. That was great. Yeah, take action. That's where it's at.
Motivation.
You might fall, scuff your knees up. What'd you do with your kid when you fell off your bike or you were running and you fell? Did you stop running or did you stop riding the bike? Yeah, you got up, cried a little bit, brushed your knee off, and went about it. You didn't quit. But a lot of people, if they have a failure to their goals, they do a real estate deal and they didn't make any money or they lose a little money. Quit.
And even worse, they want to whine about it to everybody else. Nobody gives a shit.
It was a contract. It was this guy's fault. It was that guy's fault. It's never themselves.
And even if it was somebody else's fault, at the end of the day, it's still your problem.
And you will learn more from your failures than you ever will from your successes. Every time I failed in life or in business, that's where I learned. So what I did is the next time, I sidestepped and made an adjustment so that wouldn't happen again.
The next two slides are yours.
Cool. Like the Nike commercial, just do it. So again, we kind of hammered this a little bit all during the meeting tonight. It's about posting those goals, holding yourself accountable, reading it every day, and maybe get an accountability partner. It doesn't even have to be in New York. It can be somebody in California, you know, a good friend. Preferably somebody in the same business, though.
Yeah, I'm kind of baffled by it. Somebody told me that this friend of mine, he was training for triathlon. He's like, oh, I got a personal trainer. And then he tells me one more time his personal trainer is promoted, that he just talks to him on the phone. I'm like, what? Like, this is crazy. But there's a lot of people doing that as a business, and it's still just as effective. I mean, as if you met with the person.
Called like Peloton.
Yeah.
Yeah, that thing is just skyrocketing.
People love that.
But we had accountability groups as a coaches, like five or six of us. But you know, I found out it's really tough getting all five or six on conference call one time every week. We did that for a year or two and then it kind of faded off. I'm thinking it's probably better just to do it with maybe three people, but do it just one-on-one.
And that's a good part of what is important about this group, you know, is because I get to check in with other people that are doing this and it helps me stay motivated to do things and keep up with what I plan to do. I keep my goals in my bag. Like, I have them with me everywhere I go on a sheet, so in the morning I can look up for the quarter, look at where I'm at, and I kind of make sure that what I'm doing today lines up with what my goals are for the first quarter. If it doesn't, I can change it. You know, I'm not committed to what, just because it's on my to-do list. If it looks stupid and I'm like wasting time, I can kind of recalibrate myself a little bit before I'm wasting a whole day.
It's a great thing to read in the morning when you first get up.
Yeah, it's good. You're drinking that first cup of coffee.
All of a sudden, you're not going to watch as much TV. You're going to get out the door in the morning a little quicker.
Beats reading the negative news, right?
That's a good reason to get out the door anyway.
Right. Daily.
Daily. Look at them every day. Again, execute your game plan. And also, but how you're going to achieve those goals. Again, this is all stuff we just went over. got to knock 30 doors a week, send 100 letters a month, whatever it is you're using, you're going to scour the MLS religiously, and you're going to put, 30 minutes a day in scouring the MLS to look for deals. Call the listing service.
Yeah, get on a realtor's search. Go in, meet with a realtor that understands investment property. Let me make that caveat. Mm. Have them put you on a search so that you're getting listings when they hit the MLS.
Yeah, we can put you on a search that says if you're looking for single family houses from 0 to 75 or 100 in three different school districts, we can put you, enter those parameters in the computer, it'll email you automatically. We don't have to do anything after you set it up.
Hey, yeah, they'll tell them that.
Oh yeah, we do that every day. Slave over that computer. Just do it, damn it. Just do it.
So you got your marching orders, you got your goals. Go out there. I'm
going to give you one rental tip while you're here. Never, ever, ever enter or end your leases in the winter. Nothing good comes from a vacant property in the winter. Nothing. You got to heat it, don't you? Then the electric goes off because there's a massive snowstorm came in and your pipes freeze and break, and it's just a mess. So we just signed a lease last week, but we ended it end of April. And it's real easy how you do that. You just tell the people, say, hey, look, at our company, we have rent protection. So you can sign a 14-month lease or a 16-month lease. Which one would you prefer? 16? Okay, now we're gonna end it in May. And besides, you don't want to really move in the winter anyway if you decide to move in a year because it's snow and it's cold. And bad. I've never had anybody ever turn me down.
Did anybody ever ask you how is that rent protection?
Because your rent's not going up after 12 months.
All right.
It's in our lease automatically. If
okay.
Do you extend that to evictions then too, like going to evict somebody in January?
I'm really reluctant sometimes to kick people out. Even, it's like if I can get any money out of them at all, I'm paying the heat in January or February, it's one more month. However, I will file guaranteed this time of year right away because people are getting tax returns. Mm-hmm. So I want to get that healthy judgment right now because the tax returns are coming and I can probably get it. Get caught up. But if you don't file in January, you screw around, you're losing that money as soon as spring comes around. They're out.
My wife, she's a hatchet lady. You don't bet you're out. Love
that.
Income tax returns are coming. We got to get some, as long as we're getting some money out of them until the tax returns come back and they pay off all those Christmas gifts, stretch Armstrong about it.
Anybody have any properties that?
I got a 4-unit in Steelton in great condition with a brick garage, 130.
Seems pretty good. 130 grand for a 4-unit with a garage.
Oh, good chance. And I got some German Shepherd puppies that are 10 days old. Starting to walk. It looked like me coming home a couple weeks ago.
Anybody else? You got some stuff, Brandon?
I have a 3-unit in Dallas on D-Pad. Rents suck, but there's lots of upscale, going it. It's got parking in the back for about 6-8 cars. You could add more if you wanted to. Consists of a 3-bedroom and 2 1-bedrooms. Got a washer and dryers in them. It's just a nice building. I'm asking $140 for it. I can do seller financing on it if you want to get creative on it. I have some stuff for guys that are looking for stuff that they don't have to do anything with in the city. In the 50s for single family homes that are rent ready, don't have to touch them. There's some other guys in New York who are selling rent ready stuff for $80,000, $90,000, $100,000 to guys. I'm selling for $50,000 or $60,000.
I like your buy-sell trade pitches are getting better.
Speaking of that, what I was just talking about, Brian and I, we went out for a couple beers the other night. My wife said, how long are you going to be gone? I said, the whole time.
Jeff, do you have something?
Yeah. I've got a cash flow rental duplex in Hanover, Southwest Schools. A good area there. Two units, fully rented, cash flow property from day number one. I have a few more of these back here.
Nice.
You said a duplex, you got both sides?
It's a half a house. Well, it's a whole house divided in half.
So you got both sides?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks.
I like duplexes personally because the person, it's a half. They got a basement, they got nobody above them, nobody below them.
Tenants pay all utilities, separate utilities.
Definitely something to be said for that. Anybody else say anything for sale?
Is this just a sale or looking for buy?
You can say if there's something very specific you're looking to buy, but a lot of people are buying stuff. So
I'm in the middle of a 1031 exchange. I'm looking to buy a 6 to 10 unit or so property and probably priced between $300,000 and $450,000. I don't care where it is, but I'm getting close to the 45 day mark, so I need to get some stuff identified.
Perfect. Okay. Anybody else?
Yeah, sir.
Go ahead.
Hi, me again. I didn't understand how many of you guys were interested in buying when I stood up and gave my little spiel in the beginning. I'm currently building a buyer's list. I'm operating in Harrisburg, but in the whole region. I'm bootstrapping a wholesaling operation. If you're interested in getting leads that I'm getting, please come find me and give me your card. We'll have a chat and I'll get you the specifics of what you're looking for. Thank you.
So we're looking to buy too. Everybody got something they want to sell.
Harry mentioned the puppy.
I'm a girl.
Why?
I don't know.
You could be like Ray. Ray and Boo there.
No, that's a pure head one.
Yeah, that's
good. It's amazing calm.
He doesn't have it anymore.
No,
it's
no.
Not having it anymore.
You're
on that personal note, what do you guys think of all the lottery tickets and they got slot machines now everywhere?
Oh, ridiculous.
It's crazy. I know. The other day I went to the grocery store, got 2 dozen eggs, cost me $428.
That's inflation.
So, a couple things coming up. Next month, please be advised what the topic is. We'll let you know. It'll be at the same location. The following month, March, Equity Trust is going to be here for the meeting. They do self-directed IRAs. And when I say that, it's self-directed IRAs that you get to direct what the funds are invested in. So if you want to use them for hard money lending or if you want to buy a specific property, they're going to talk about the ins and outs of that. They're also going to be doing an all-day wealth building workshop the Saturday following the meeting here at the hotel. That will cost something. It'll be pretty reasonable, like $300 or less, I think. Very beneficial to go to. I went to the one in Baltimore, and there'll be a lot of people there that are from their client base, so that have accounts, and that they're doing this actively. And they'll tell you the ins and outs of what to do, how to do it. They're just going to tell you about the concept of the meeting. Very powerful concept, particularly for those of you guys that are doing wholesaling, because if you take title in the entity versus taking title under your own name, and you have a capital gain, if the entity happens to be a Roth IRA, for example, that capital gain is a gain of the portfolio, not a personal gain of yours. So that's something to keep in mind. I probably have to give a disclosure. I'm not an accountant, CPA, or anything like that. But it's not. I'm not even selling the product. Just come to the meeting. That's what I'm selling.
And that's the Saturday after our meeting.
It is. That is. But our meeting, the guy will be here to talk about. Guy or girl, I don't know who they're going to send me out. If you know anybody else that might be interested in something like that, I'm trying to get the word out now before it occurs. But more networking. after this in the lounge.
And if you know anybody that's looking for any quality German Shepherd puppy,
you can send it 5 times and have a patient to pray.
Yeah.
And we'll talk. Dave and I want to thank everybody for coming, and we hope you'll follow through with these goals. And you'll be amazed at the success next year when you're here. And we want to hear about it. All right, thank you.
Central PA, I got that. Real estate investors meetup. I forgot the meetup part. Okay, so it's okay, gotcha.
It should be on every player.
Okay, gotcha. Thank you.
Yep.